It is said that vacations can generally be categorized as being relaxing or exhausting, rejuvenating or adventurous. The Chase family wanted a different type of vacation. Too many times, they had chosen the former, needing the relaxation to offset the everyday grind. This time, Jack Chase recommended something different for his family. He wanted to experience the outdoors in a different way than he and his family ever had. He convinced his wife Terry and 8-year-old daughter Liz that they should venture up an isolated mountain pass with packs for a short 3-day outing, a true experience with nature, all alone in the outdoors. Jack was aware of the Bitterroot Mountains near Wisdom, Montana, but never visited. This seemed like the right location for the adventure that he and his family would never forget. After the 3-hour drive northwest from Rexburg, with packs prepared, the family parks the car and ventures into the majestic canyon. The three companions start up a lonely game trail alongside a small stream that meanders through the willows and under fallen logs, bordered by steep mountain walls on either side, in some places only wide enough to traverse barely without getting the feet wet. The canyon is buzzing with insects, working with fury to accomplish their undefined life mission. Trees are active with ground squirrels and assortments of native birds, which study the three in part with curiosity, but more with suspicion. After 2 hours of walking the narrow game trail, the family spots a fishing game warden and his apprentice traveling out of the canyon opposite them. The three are thrilled to see another set of humans, providing some assurance that the lonely passage they are on must lead to something grand. As the family of three approaches, they stop for a friendly discussion, where it becomes clear that there is an unexpectedly perplexed countenance on the warden's face. While outlining their planned adventure of 3 days and nights in the wilderness, the warden develops a look of concern. Not wanting to arouse concern for the safety of the one who he is now biased as an inexperienced outdoorsman, his unprepared spouse and charming but unfit for the wild 8-year-old daughter, the warden advises that it would be unwise to travel further without being armed, the warden making this assumption of no protection based on his observation. The warden is quickly interrupted by Jack, who then assures him that he is indeed armed with a rifle, giving a slight twist of the body and exposing the end of the barrel projecting from his pack. It is a second-hand New England firearm, or NEF, single-shot 20-gauge brake barrel. Hardly enough to take down a rabbit, but the warden isn't aware of this, as this detail is not disclosed. The warden, taking Jack aside and motioning with the tilt of his head to his colleague to carry on a diversional conversation with Terry and Liz, remarks with a somber face and low vocal tone.
Hey, mister, you need to understand that this is not a place for a family of three. There are strange going-ons here that are even unsettling for the most prepared.
Jack listens intently with an amiable countenance baked onto his face from years of living a life of comfort and safety.
Well, that's part of the adventure,
Jack replies back, with an apparent ignorance of whatever information is present within the more informed warden's mind.
That's what this trip is all about, getting away and experiencing things that we would never do in the city.
Jack expresses with enthusiasm.
You certainly would not experience things like this in the city. Things that you will encounter out here. Listen, I don't want to tell you what to do, but you need to keep that rifle ready, you understand? For the protection of your family there, and for your own safekeeping.
The warden pauses.
Understand that out here, you are the one person that stands between the fury of the wild and your family's well-being. Sir, have you ever read Theodore Roosevelt's Bauman story from his book, The Wilderness Hunter? Well, this canyon is the actual location of that story. The story didn't end well.
Well, I guess if it was written by Theodore Roosevelt, that had to have been some time ago. Maybe in the 19th century? What happened? Did someone get eaten by a bear?
Jack responds with sincere curiosity.
Sir, I suggest you keep that weapon loaded and keep it close. Grow eyes in the back of your head and listen to your senses.
The warden gives Jack an involuntary wink and tips his hat.
Ma'am, you be careful during your stay.
The two companions move on, never providing the typical smile of assurance that would be a normal gesture of tribute when parting company.
Well, they seem nice.
Terry comments, excited to continue onward and oblivious to the warnings Jack just received.
Yeah, genuinely concerned for his safety.
The family of three continues on for another 2 hours, finally arriving at an open glade with nearby beaver ponds.
Beautiful. Shall we make camp here?
Jack inquires as his companions start shedding their packs.
I have never in my entire life experienced outdoor camping like this.
As the family proceeds to unload their packs and make camp, the afternoon transitions rapidly to an early evening, hastened by the sunlight's inability to reach the deep floor of the canyon. With tent erected, sleeping bags unfurled, and a small campfire now burning, it is the image unlike no other. A pure connection with Mother Earth and her caretakers. Terry offers to start heating water for the planned dehydrated meals they brought along while Liz makes herself busy climbing a rock wall and cleaning out a small cave inset to the granite mountainside with a small perch overlooking the camp from a height of 12 feet. Observing the rising of trout in the nearby pond, Jack readies a fly rod and heads over to snag one of the eager fish hungry for a meal. It is paradise. Life as God meant it to be. It feels surreal. The three enjoy their made-ready meals and sit around the campfire using a fallen tree as their bench. Jack tells stories, and they all laugh, recalling warm memories of times past. Before they realize it, there is no more glow from the warm, reassuring sun, and the camp is swallowed whole by the blackness of night. The forest becomes still, and save the steady sound of the trickling water in the nearby stream, the only sound present is the popping of hot embers in the dying fire. Rubbing her arms, pulled in tight to preserve body heat, Terry comments that maybe it's time to turn in. The fire diminishes to nothing more than red-hot coals, pulsating hypnotically, the final transition toward oxide white ash. Jack and daughter Liz end their fascinated inspection of the star-filled sky, and the three make their way to the tent and slip into their warm sleeping bags. Hastened by the exhaustive hike, Liz is the first to fall into a deep sleep, followed closely by Terry. The two knowing that they are under the safe, protective watch by Jack. For Jack, however, the burden is on him to fulfill his role as designated protector. When setting up the tent earlier, Jack had laid his rifle to the side of his sleeping bag, where he now rests his hand. A single cartridge has been already loaded into the breech, one of three cartridges Jack brought along on the trip. This is his sole source of protection from the unknown, lurking in the dark, silent forest night. At about 2 a.m., Jack is startled awake by what he does not know. It is a moment of confusion where one wakes up, at first unsure of where they are, and then slowly transitions into awareness. Jack lays there silently, wondering what awoke him. He depresses the small button on his watch, illuminating a small, dim light, making it possible for him to read the time. He looks over in the darkness, barely being able to make out the silhouettes of his wife and daughter lying next to him, with the scarce light from the slight glow of the tent top provided by the stars above. Lying there, Jack begins to recount the events of the preceding day. The incredible hike, the scenery, the discussion with the warden, the time at the pond catching small hungry brook trout, and the time spent around the fire. His colorful, comforting thoughts, however, receive a harsh interruption by a loud thump outside the tent, quickly changing his countenance from a look of glee to one of dismay. The distinctive sound of a heavy rock hitting the solid ground and then rolling to a stop.
What the crap?
Jack thinks, as the unsettling event sends adrenaline coursing through his veins. He reaches over, feeling for the shotgun as he lay there listening. It is an awkward moment where he feels his body in a state of high alert, while his wife and daughter sleep peacefully beside him, completely unaware. For some time, Jack hears nothing. Listening intently, he comes to the realization that the sound must have come from a dislodged rock from his daughter's exploit into the cave overlooking the camp the preceding evening.
That's it.
Jack laughs to himself.
Wow, that scared the crap out of me.
Smiling and laughing in silence, Jack lays there, thinking of what a funny story it will be during the following morning's breakfast. The smile on his face slowly passes as the seconds tick on. Before he realizes it, Jack is again fast asleep. An hour passes by for the three slumbering souls under the watchful eye of the dark forest when Jack is once again awakened. Wiping his eyes, Jack's hearing suddenly comes to as if something has turned on the volume knob, an internal alarm designed to wake him with a moment's notice in the case of something not being right. As he lays there, Jack hears distinct footsteps of an animal outside the tent. Something large. Whatever the thing, it slowly wanders about the camp, cracking the occasional stick underfoot and breathing deeply. Once again, with his wife and daughter still sound asleep, Jack reaches for the comfort of his rifle. He slowly cocks the hammer back, ending with a distinct sound of a click as the hammer comes to full stop. The movement of the creature stops. After a pause, Jack can clearly hear the animal walking closer toward the tent. Jack's body is on high alert, and with his heart about to jump through his chest, the creature then makes contact with the tent, making a deep compression into the top cover.
Go away, Bear!
Shouts Jack through the thin nylon tent material, unsure of what to say, but compelled to raise an alarm.
What's wrong?
A tired voice comes from Terry.
It's okay. It was just an animal in our camp.
Jack whispers.
What kind of animal?
Inquires Liz.
It's okay. It's gone now. Go back to sleep.
Jack assures. As his two female companions drift back to sleep, Jack hears the nerve-rattling scream of a creature not so far off in the forest. It's unlike anything Jack has ever heard. Terry awakes halfway once more, saying,
What'd you say?
In a tired, half-asleep voice. Creepy, murmurs Jack, with his eyes wide open, seeing nothing but blackness. The morning greets the family of three with the usual bright sounds of nature. The chirping of birds, the persistent knocking of a woodpecker, and the distinctive sound of a crow cawing to its mate, accompanied by the echo off the canyon walls. Jack is the first to crawl out of the tent as rays of sunlight kiss the earth. Comfort in being back in the light at last after a long night. Jack starts a new fire as his two female colleagues emerge from the tent. Wasting no time getting to the subject, Terry asks,
So, what did you hear last night?
With quick thinking, intended to maintain a sense of safety, Jack responds,
I think it was coyotes.
Well, if they come back again, maybe just shoo them off, you think?
Terry, not at all aware of the seemingly near-death experience that had transpired while she and her daughter rested peacefully.
Go catch us breakfast,
Terry says to Jack with her comforting smile. He grabs his fly rod and walks over to the nearby pond, which is by now bubbling with the rise of 100 hungry brook trout. Liz digs through her pack for the slingshot she brought along. Looking around, she finds a very old rusty steel can near camp and sets it on a fallen log that is now referred to as the bench. She fires one rock at a time at the can, hitting closer to her intended target with each shot. Simultaneously, in short time, Jack catches as many trout as the family of three are able to eat and heads back to the campfire. Terry has everything prepared, ready to throw the fish in the heated frying pan. Once again, paradise is presented to the three as they enjoy a hearty breakfast provided by nature within the beautiful primeval forest. With this start of a new day, Jack all but forgets about the previous night's experience, his inner conscience busy at work washing undesirable memories of last night clean and replacing them with the warm, bright memories created just in the morning. Jack announces that he wants to explore a bit with his fly rod. Terry is all the more ready to stay behind at camp with little Liz. Jack removes his shotgun from the tent and rests it up against a nearby log.
Just in case it's needed,
he announces to Terry.
Keep away from it, Liz. It's just for your mom and I if we need it for protection,
he says as he walks away.
I'll be back within, say, a couple of hours.
Eager to start reading the new book that Terry picked up before the trip, Terry lays out a blanket in a shaded area and sits down to read while Liz begins exploring about, slingshot in hand. A half hour passes when Liz calls out to her mother to come look at a discovery of hers. Terry casually wanders over, her hands resting on her protruding hips, and to her amazement, finds the footprint of a gigantic bipedal animal centered in the soft soil between her daughter's feet. At first, Terry believes it to be a creation of her daughter's, squatting down to make a closer inspection. As she looks forward, she sees similar footprints continuing in a line forward. The prints being ridiculously large for any normal human being. The only conclusion that can be drawn is that they are not human, and they appear fresh. Liz looks up to her mother with concern.
Is it a bear?
She asks. Alarmed, Terry pulls her daughter closer, now scanning the woods for some explanation for the giant prints. Well aware of the legend of Bigfoot, Terry has not discounted the possibility of the prints being made by such a creature, as much as she would like to. Now her concern shifts to her husband, who is somewhere out there in the thick forest, an unprepared lone wanderer. But then the concern shifts back to her and her daughter's well-being.
Stay close to me,
remarks Terry. The concern, now contagious, is transferred to her daughter, who has a steady stream of questions about the mysterious footprints. Liz goes back to working on her hideout, the cave overlooking the camp, driven perhaps by the fresh concern of an unwelcome wanderer within the forest. As time approaches noon, Terry anxiously awaits the return of her husband. She has made more than one attempt to refocus, to divert her concerns away from the intimidating footprints by focusing on her book, but with no success. Suddenly, the forest turns quiet. There is no chirping of the birds, no busying sounds of insects, no joyful sound of active ground squirrels. Only the distant, perpetual trickling sound coming from the nearby stream. Then, out of nowhere, a lone forest voice is projected, not too far from camp. The high-pitched, threatening scream of an undefined beast. Terry jumps to her feet, alarmed. And now being driven by instinct, runs to the protection of her daughter. She scales the rock embankment, joining her daughter in the shallow granite cave overlooking camp. Her drive to protect her daughter is further enforced as the two hear the smashing of a great body entering the camp from the forest trees. Terry holds her daughter tight, staying low. The two only raising their heads enough to see the campsite without being fully exposed. They then see the giant form enter the campsite, walking on 2 feet. A large, dark brown, hairy, ape-like beast, standing a minimum of 9 feet high, and having the girth of a fully matured grizzly bear. The beast carefully scans the area with its ape-like face and its intensely focused eyes, unaware of being observed by the two human trespassers at the elevated position.
What is it?
Liz whispers.
Shh,
responds Terry, as Liz begins to whimper in terror. Terry slowly moves her hand in position to cover her daughter's mouth. Discovery is not an option in this horrifying game of hide-and-seek. The beast slowly moves about, trying to seek out the trespassers using all primitive senses. It wanders closer to the two hidden humans perched slightly above line of sight. Directly below the two now, there is no opportunity for full concealment. Only the hope that the beast does not raise its eyes to the position above it. Its ape-like nose moves deliberately as it raises its head slightly, sampling the surrounding air. It has caught the scent of the forest intruders, but has not yet spotted them. Terry and Liz crouch mortified and shivering beyond any ability to control. Terry now realizes that she has lost all sensation in her legs, resulting from the kneeling in this awkward position, the blood within her not circulating to her legs. If she had to stand and run now, she would be unable on account of her legs falling asleep. Tears stream from Liz's face as it takes every ounce of restraint she has to keep from screaming in terror, while Terry continually whispers a barely distinguishable shh in her daughter's ear. A mild, deep-toned growl can be heard as the beast uses its extreme sense of smell and hearing to seek out its prey. Slightly moving its huge head to the left and back to the right. All the while, the foul odor of the beast presents itself to the two in an all-out assault on the two human sense of smell. Finally, the beast raises its projected glance, beginning to pan to the left and upward, closer to the hiding place of the two. Terry begins to feel that all is lost at this point. No way to protect her and her daughter, no possibility to flee. All of a sudden, the sound of footsteps come running into the camp.
Terry! Liz! Did you hear that?
Jack has returned to the camp and turns to face the giant beast standing between the tent and his wife and daughter. Shocked at the unexpected sight, Jack freezes without any clear direction as to what to do. The beast immediately approaches him without haste. Jack remembers the shotgun and makes a move to secure it while there's time. He grabs a hold of the neff and cocks the hammer. As he rotates to face the charging beast, he discharges a round in the middle of the weapon and in no direct path of harm to the snarling beast, who is now even further enraged. The beast grabs a hold of Jack, lifting him with ease and tossing him up in the air. Jack manages his return to the hard ground as best he can, but not without putting a strain on his left ankle, with a poor landing. Applying what Jack has learned about bear attacks, he clasps his hands around his neck, protecting his vitals, as the beast proceeds to slap around his helpless body with fury, bloodying Jack's nose and making a mark across Jack's face. "Play dead," Jack thinks to himself. While maintaining the position of his hands around his neck, he allows his body to go limp. The beast pauses his attack and, in confusion, begins to refocus on his objective of finding the others that he knows from his senses must be present. As the beast turns and starts to move away from Jack, Jack carefully reaches into his pocket to find the second of three 20-gauge cartridges. The gun was thrown 8 feet from where he now lays, and Jack realizes that it will take every bit of effort for him to reach it quickly. Jack secures the round in his right hand, but as he makes a move to reposition his hand to cover his neck, the beast detects movement and quickly stomps back over to look for signs of life. Terry and Liz look on horrified at what is unfolding in front of them, still shivering and frozen with fear. Not seeing movement, the beast once again turns away from Jack. A moment passes as it scans the campsite once again. Jack looks up to his wife and daughter and motions to them to stay quiet, assuring them, for the moment at least, he's okay. Without notice, the beast's attention is immediately drawn to a rust-colored object making noise and moving erratically across the ground. Liz has shot the can with her slingshot, confusing the great giant, who then goes on to attack the strange moving object. Jack jumps into action. He springs for the rifle, limping and crawling to it as fast as his injured ankle allows. He folds open the brake barrel, ejecting the spent cartridge, and inserts another while the beast once again charges toward him. Slamming the barrel closed, Jack pulls back the hammer, and without time for careful aiming, discharges the round into the huge, hairy thigh of the approaching beast, and remains more than 10 feet from doom, stopping the charge. Now driven by an extreme sensation of pain, the beast releases a cursing scream. Jack fumbles for his third and final round. Breaking open the barrel, the spent cartridge is released, and he drives in the third cartridge. The beast, apparently in a show of some sign of intelligence, or perhaps reacting to his primitive fight-or-flight instinct, leaves the site with a large show of blood, leaving a trail behind. Wasting no time, Terry stands as best as her numb legs will allow, and she and Liz emerge from the cave and drop down into the campground. Without any need for coordination, the three take for the trail as quick as Jack's defunct ankle and Terry's slightly paralyzed legs will allow, leaving everything behind. Terry stands to Jack's side, supporting him on the left and helping him make haste as the three proceed forward. Liz leading by a good distance ahead and looking back every 2 seconds. With his right hand, Jack continues to grasp the rifle, the only tool that stands between the fury of the wild and the safety of his family. No more than 5 minutes have passed when the three travelers hear the horrifying scream of the enraged beast once again in pursuit. Moving as fast as they can, they hear the beast once again emerge from the woods behind them, realizing that there is no way to outrun the beast. The fight sensation now takes over for Jack. He turns to the beast as Terry runs forward to her daughter. Jack takes aim as the distempered primate moves without hesitation. The creature's thigh, now completely blood-soaked, the beast is now clearly ready to finish what the ill-tempered mammal started. Jack is prepared to unload his final round into the face of the approaching beast, but must wait until the monster is close enough so as to not miss the one and only shot left that will determine the life of he and his family or the death of all. Holding steady with hammer cocked and a steady finger on the trigger, Jack readies himself for the final act of desperation. On three, he thinks, as the beast approaches. One. Two. Without warning, the distinctive shot of a firearm comes from behind. Remaining focused, Jack stands ready to pull the trigger. But the attack from the beast is brought to an immediate halt. Bewildered, Jack turns to see the warden and apprentice quickly moving their way up the path, behind Jack and his desperate family. The warden passes Jack and motions for Jack to move behind.
Move back! I've got this under control!
The warden's eyes are locked onto the wounded beast as he continues to move toward it, rifle barrel aimed directly toward the beast's vitals. The beast stares back, apparently reconsidering its pursuit. It is as if the warden and the beast have a common understanding of one another, as if they have come face to face before. The man-ape slowly is reduced from a snarling beast to an animal in pain. It slowly turns, looking back one final time at the warden, who is still locked onto his target, and it retreats into the darkness of the woods. The battered and emotionally exhausted Chase family continue their four-hour walk back to the trailhead, happily escorted by the warden and his apprentice, who remain in intense focus the entire journey.
Dad.
Liz looks over at Jack.
I don't want to go camping anymore.
This is our sin, but I still believe.